can hear him.
Good, good, good. A man disappears more than a woman in a magic show, I tell you. Well, this morning I just want you to know that I've been doing some investigating. I've been especially investigating the investigator. An investigator by the name of Luke, a first century doctor. And if you're here this morning and you don't like one of those hell and brimstone type sermons, well, today may be the very day for you to be here, because I ain't got one. If you're here today and you like a church that speaks the absolute truths of the Scripture, well, I'm glad you're here today, or any Sunday, because I believe that we always speak the absolute truths of the Scripture, the full counsel of the Gospel of God. If you're here today and you're one of those people who likes facts and figures and analysis, well, it's a great day for you to be here as well, because I've done a lot of investigating, and I've got a lot of facts and a lot of history, and I think that by the time we're done, we're going to be able to show you not only who Luke is, but why Luke writes. Now, if you're here today, and you have some questions about who Jesus is, if you have some questions as to what's going on in your life, if you have some questions if Jesus truly is who he says he is, then today may be especially a great day for you to be here. Because Luke, this historian, this doctor, tells us why he writes and how we can be certain. Today is a great day, regardless of where you are, to be at the Elohim Church. So today we're going to look at the writings of predominantly the first three verses, I'm sorry, the first four verses, the three first sentences in what we call the Gospel of Luke. We're going to be investigating an investigator. And this companion of Paul the Apostle, this man by name Luke, went on many of Paul's missionary trips. So, we're going to start by investigating, like I said, just the first three sentences of the Gospel of Luke, first four verses. And gospel translates into good news. So you know it can't be good news unless it's gospel. So you know today's message has to be good news. Well, that's just elementary, my dear. Most of you know the Bible is broken down into two parts. Two large parts, anyway. The Old Testament and the New Testament. And the Old Testament ends with the prophet Malachi. And in the prophet Malachi, he writes four chapters, and the last two sentences of the fourth chapter, the last two sentences of the entire Old Testament read like this. Look, I am sending you the prophet Elijah before the great and dreadful day of the Lord arrives. His preaching will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and to the hearts of the children to their fathers. Otherwise, I will come and I will strike the land with a curse. And then God goes silent for 400 years. No saith the Lord, no dreams, no visions, nothing. God is silent for 400 years. Then all of a sudden, the deafening silence is shattered, and Luke records it. And Luke records it with these great angelic appearances. Luke records God sends an angel to a priest by the name of Zechariah. Now, we talked about all this in our last sermon series, the hymns of Luke. He sends this angel to Zechariah with great news. And the great news of great joy was that Zechariah and his wife, who was way beyond any childbearing years, would have a son. And he wouldn't have just any son. He would have the son named John that would announce the coming of the long-awaited prophet, the long-awaited Messiah, the long-awaited anointed of Jesus Christ, the long-awaited of our Savior. And God begins to speak once again. Folks, God has not stopped speaking since. what wonderful news that we have today. What Luke begins to say is that this man named John will come in the spirit of Elijah. Exact fulfillment of the last two sentences in all of the Old Testament. See, here's one thing we know about God. He always keeps his promises. God begins to speak. Now the fact is, if Luke hadn't written his gospel, much of what we know about Jesus and his ministry and his life is primarily a Jewish audience. So when you read the genealogy in Matthew or the ancestry of Jesus, Matthew goes back to Abraham because Abraham was the father of the Jewish race. But Luke, when he writes his genealogy, he goes all the way back to our universal ancestor. He goes all the way to the beginning of creation. Luke takes his account all the way back to Adam because he's writing to non-Jews. He's writing to Gentiles. They don't care about Abraham. The other thing is, in Matthew's gospel, when you read it, you'll find that Matthew continually references the Old Testament to show the fulfillment of Jesus Christ, the Old Testament prophecy. But not Luke. Luke very seldom mentions the Old Testament. The question becomes why, and the answer is simply, why would he? The Gentile audience would have never read what we call the Old Testament, the Jewish scriptures. They would have never read the Torah and the law and the prophets. So they would have had no idea that Jesus is fulfilling these prophecies. Luke's writing specifically to show us that Jesus Christ is the Savior, the Messiah to the entire world, and that Jesus Christ comes as the Son of Man. So, Matthew uses phrases like, this was done so what the Lord had proclaimed might be fulfilled. But Luke doesn't use words like that because his Gentile audience wouldn't have any knowledge of the Hebrew Bible. They would have never read the Jewish Bible or their prophets or what we know as the Old Testament. So the audience doesn't know the Jewish prophecies. So Luke concentrates on Jesus as God, the Son of Man. That's why Luke takes the genealogy all the way back to Adam, all the way back to the very first human, the universal ancestor to each one of us. Luke wants to show us that Jesus Christ is the Savior to the entire world, that he didn't come just to save the Jewish people. He came to save all of us. Another clue we get that Luke is a Gentile is Luke often translates Hebrew words into Greek. For example, in the book of Luke, you'll never find him using the word Jesus as rabbi. He always calls him the master. Because his Gentile audience to rabbi wouldn't have meant anything. Master would have, because they're Romans. They are people who are used to slavery and having masters or being a master. So we believe that not only was Luke a Gentile, but he was writing to a Gentile audience. For example, in Luke chapter 2, he says that Jesus is the light to the Gentiles. In chapter 3, he quotes the book of Isaiah chapter 40 by saying that all flesh will see God's salvation. Another great statement about Luke's gospel is this is a great book of rejoicing. It begins with happiness. It begins with singing. It begins with God answering the prayers of an old man and an old woman to have this child, and not just any child, but the one that's going to announce the coming Messiah, the Savior to the world. And Luke ends with triumph, as we see as Luke ends his gospel with Jesus Christ ascending up into heaven with his arms outstretched and the disciples going out into the world to spread the good news of the gospel. It says, and the power of God was working through them. He opens with singing. He opens with rejoicing, as we saw in our last series, the hymns of Luke. Just in the first two chapters, there's five songs that Luke writes He uses words like laughter, rejoice, sing, happiness. All of this is in the Gospel of Luke. He knows that we can be filled for joy. Why does he know, and why does he write so much about rejoicing and joy? Because he knows that the Savior has come for him, that the Savior has come for his family and his friends. He knows that the Savior is not just here to save the Jews, but he's here to save everyone. When you know the source of life and the giver of life, when you know the one who gave you life and keeps giving you life, how can you not have anything but joy? And these are the words of Luke. This is what he wants us to see. Sherlock Holmes sort of words. That's elementary. If you know the source and the giver of your life, how can you not have joy if you know him in a personal and intimate way? So if you have the Bibles this morning, then you can come to church. You should have your Bibles. If you don't have one, there's some up there for you to take one. We're going to be looking at the first chapter of Luke, as I said earlier. And this is what we're going to be concentrating on. Just the introduction to it. And this is not going to be a long series, but we're going to try to hit the highlights of the book of Luke. But I want to start with just the introduction. Now, in order so that you can know that I investigated the investigator, I not only looked at what we know about Luke from Scripture, but I also began to look at what the secular world, what history, what those who aren't Christians have said about Luke. Now, without giving you an entire history lesson and spending a lot of time on that, what I found out is some documents that were found in the 8th century. And one of these documents was called the Prologue to Luke. The prologue is like an introduction. It tells you a little bit about the person. And in this Prologue of Luke, which isn't in your Bibles, but it is considered to be very reliable historical information. It's a very reliable historical account. And what it tells us is that Luke is originally from Syria. He's a Syrian, which means he's a Gentile. That confirms that he's a Gentile. Now, Luke may have, later in life, converted to Judaism, which meant he became a Jew by going through a religious ceremony before he became a Jesus follower, before he became what we call a Christian in today's world. But the prologue tells us that Luke was a doctor by profession. Now, we also have evidence of that, and that is confirmed in the Scriptures. In Colossians chapter 4, verse 10, Paul says, Luke, the beloved doctor, sends his greetings. So we have both secular history, something that doesn't have anything at all to do with Scripture, and we have Scripture that both confirm that there was a man by the name of Luke and that he was a doctor. Other references show us that Luke was a very well-educated man. I've read and I've been told, and I'm not a Greek scholar, that in this introduction particularly, but throughout the Gospel of Luke, that Luke writes with the highest degree of Greek that's ever been found. It's comparable. The other book in our Bibles that's written in this type of Greek is the book of Hebrews. But this is not just the greatest Greek that's been found in our Bible. It's some of the greatest writings in Greek that's ever been found in both secular writings and in world writing. So we know that Luke was a very educated man. He has the highest quality, the most refined in all of the New Testament in all the world. Now Luke was especially versed in two areas, especially versed in nautical terms and especially versed in medical terms. For example, when Luke speaks about the medical conditions of the people that Jesus is healing, he's much more specific and uses different terms than Matthew and John and Mark uses. He uses the terms that a doctor would use. He uses the type of language that we would expect a well-educated doctor to travel a lot by ship to talk about. He would have nautical terms. He would add a college of medical terms. The Luke goes on, the prologue, this ancient document that was found in the 8th century, probably written somewhere around 100 AD, which would give, you know, that's only about 70 years after the death of Jesus, so there were people that were still alive that knew Luke, tells us that not only was Luke a doctor, not only was he well educated, but Luke was a disciple of the apostles. And again, it tells us that he followed Paul into his martyrdom when Paul was executed, when he was killed for his preaching of Jesus Christ in Rome. And that Luke served the Lord blamelessly. Now, this is something else that's verified in Scripture. Paul tells of Luke, and in Luke's second book of what we call the book of Acts, but more accurately should be named and is named in a lot of the older ones, the Acts of the Apostles, because it tells what the apostles did and where they went and what they said and what they witnessed. Luke and Paul mention Luke going on and going with him on these many, many trips. So here's what we know about Luke is that both history in the secular world has nothing to do with Christianity, and in the scriptures both say the same thing about Luke. We see Luke in the accompanying not only Paul, but meeting with and talking to the other apostles. We see that Luke met some of the other disciples. But not only does this prologue tell us that Luke was a doctor and that he was very well educated and that Luke also traveled with Paul and the other apostles, it tells us that Luke never married. He never had a wife. He never fathered children, never had any children. And that he died at the age of 84, full of the Holy Spirit in Boeotia, which is a district in ancient Greece. So as I said earlier, Luke is the longest book in the New Testament. It has more words in it than any other book. And Luke also gives us more information about Jesus and more details about the life and ministry of Jesus than any of the other gospels of Luke. But Luke is the only gospel writer that has never met Jesus. He never heard him preach, never saw him, never met him, never witnessed a miracle personally. So the question became to me as I was doing my investigating, well, how could Luke know so much more about Jesus than the people that actually witnessed Jesus, that were there with Jesus, that saw Jesus, like Mark and Peter and John and Matthew? Well, he answers that question in the very first three sentences in the very first four. He starts out like this. He says, many people have set out to write accounts about the events that have been fulfilled among us. So this wasn't something that happened years and years ago. They had been fulfilled among us. They used eyewitness reports that were circulating among us from the very early disciples, those that followed Jesus, having carefully investigated everything from the very beginning. I also decided to write a careful account for you, most honorable Theophilus, so you can be certain of the truth of everything you will have. And you still may be sitting there thinking to yourself, well, how does this answer the question, how did Luke know so much more about Jesus than those who actually walked with him, talked to him, witnessed the miracles, heard him preach? Well, Aunt Sherlock Holmes has carefully investigated the event there. So I'm going to answer your question, hopefully through the power of the Holy Spirit. Now he starts out, many people have set out to write an account about the events that have been fulfilled among us. So, keep in mind when you're wondering if the Bible is accurate, when you're wondering if Jesus is who he says he is, you know, should I really do these things? Because, you know, there's a chance that, you know, this is Jesus wasn't God. Luke was written about 25 or 30 years after the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's not like it was written 100 years later. There's still people that are walking around that knew Jesus, that was with Jesus. There were still part of his family members that were there. You know, it's possible and even probable that Luke not only talked to the apostles themselves, we know that's true because it's recorded, but that he also talked to the members of Jesus' family, that he was able to find the shepherds, that witnessed the angelic heavenly open up and sing to him. It's possible that Jesus' brothers had an opportunity to talk to Luke. Now, James, the half-brother of Jesus, and I say half-brother because God, the Holy Spirit, was the father of Jesus, and Joseph was the father of James, was martyred in about 44 A.D., so more than likely, James was already dead. But he had another brother, like James, who wrote a book in the Bible called Jude. A lot of people skip over there. It's just a chapter book, small book towards the end of the scriptures. But Jude was a half-brother of Jesus as well. I have one pastor that I follow regularly that says, that right there ought to be the most convincing argument that Jesus Christ was exactly who he says he is. Because both James and John, the brothers of Jesus, opened up their letters by saying, I, Jude, or I, James, a slave of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now let me ask you something. If you have a brother or sister, what would it take for them to convince you they were God and that they were the only way to heaven and that you ought to do everything they say? I'm telling you, my brother could walk across water and come to me and tell me, and I still wouldn't believe him. I know it. What would it take for somebody you knew personally, intimate, deeply, grew up with, to convince you that they were God and that you should submit to them and that you should do everything they say and they are the only way to heaven? See, Jude and James didn't believe Jesus. They actually thought he was crazy. They go to him one time and tell him to stop doing this. They didn't believe until Jesus Christ came in his resurrected body to them. I mean, if somebody can predict their death, predict their burial, and predict that they're going to rise again, that's probably somebody we ought to pay attention to. Might even be somebody that we ought to listen to and do what they say, right? Jude and James didn't believe Jesus until they met the resurrected Lord. All those scholars and theologians really differ to the time frame when the final draft of the Gospel of Luke was made. Some say it was as early as 58 A.D., which is only 25 years after Jesus was resurrected. Some say as late as 80 or 90 A.D. However, what it doesn't tell you, and what we won't know this side of heaven, is when he began his research. Because this was painstaking research. When we get into this, you'll see how carefully Luke was about his writings, how careful Luke was about what his research was about. Now, we know that Luke doesn't write because there's no other writings out there. Luke was so precise and so meticulous, he would have started his research much sooner than he got his final draft. But Luke tells us up front why he's writing. It says, many people have set out to write accounts about the events that have been fulfilled among us. Many people are writing about Jesus. Now, the fact that many, many people are writing about Jesus and his life and his ministry is really important, because we have to remember that texts were hard to write. They weren't widely surfaced, they weren't widely circulated at the time. There was no printing presses. There were no printing pages, so you had to be very careful when you're writing. You're writing on papers. It was very difficult to find, expensive to find, very difficult to write on. So the fact that so many people were writing about Jesus at this point in time is very significant, because it tells us how important Jesus' life was and how important his ministry was at this point in time. But Luke says, I want to write, and most, in a more appropriate word here, instead of careful, would be orderly, and we'll go into a little bit of what that means in just a few minutes. Luke says, I'm writing this because there are many out there that have been writing about this, But he says, I'm writing this because they have these events that have been fulfilled among us. Luke wants to stress the credibility of his sources. Because Luke knows no matter how much research he does, the credibility of his witnesses are going to be questioned, and that's the only way to know for sure the information he's writing about is accurate. Their writing accounts too that counteract. So he wants to be very careful in his writing so that he can put this into an event, in a series of events, that people will understand and know that's the truth. They used eyewitness reports circulating among them from the early disciples. These were the eyewitnesses. Luke was a traveling companion to the Apostle Paul. He was an eyewitness. He had met with the other apostles. He had the writings of Mark. More than likely, there's some consistency between Mark's writing and Luke's writing, to the point that Luke probably had Mark's writings in front of him. He may have had Matthew and John as well. He had walked, these people had walked with Jesus. They had talked with Jesus. They had heard his teaching. They had seen his miracles. But Dr. Luke is so careful. He's so precise. He doesn't take his word for it. He goes much deeper. He actually does a lot of homework. And then he writes, having carefully investigated. Now, the Greek word there, carefully investigated, actually means with exactness. With exactness. To follow closely. Investigated. So this wasn't something he just heard the rumor, wrote it down. Heard the rumor, wrote it down. He was writing in such a way that he would have exactness. I had carefully investigated everything from the beginning. I also had decided to write a careful account. Most translations say an orderly account. Now, when he says orderly, it is very chronological, but it's not perfectly chronological. The order that he writes in is geographical versus chronological. But Luke is the closest chronological account of Jesus that we have. But he writes in a geographic order of the places that Jesus went to. I've also decided to write a careful account for you, most honorable, or a lot of other places say, most excellent Theophilus. So Luke doesn't just investigate and then write an account. He tells us he's carefully, with exactness, investigating. And he is carefully writing this account in an orderly fashion. Because Luke knows no matter how good the research is, his writing can only be as good as the sources. So Luke is stressing the number of authors, the number of the quality of his sources. That he's telling everyone this information is just not hearsay. I was talking to the people who were actually there who saw it. And I was able to verify this through other people who saw the same thing. You can almost see him taking out his notebook and writing things down and sitting down with Mary and going, Mary, now when the angel came to you, what exactly did the angel say? He's talking to Peter. He said, Peter, when you were sitting on that beach that time, what did Jesus say to you? He's taking notes. He's looking. He's being precise. You can see him as he's meeting with people like Andrew and John and Paul. Luke is investigating the people who saw it. Luke is particularly investigating the other writings. He's looking for the reliability. And a lot of people believe, most theologians, in fact, believe that a lot of the information that Luke gets comes from Mary, Jesus' mother. I mean, when you read the first two chapters of Luke, he talks in such an intimate way. He talks in such a personal way. He talks about things that only a mother would talk about. The things that only the people that were actually there as witnesses could know. And he talks about them not as if I heard this, but almost as if he was right there. He has such credible resources. And he's talking with such clarity that only a mother would speak of their child this way and the things that went on. Luke probably even tracked down the shepherd, because he talks with such specificity and specifies so many things that he had, they had to be witnesses of the actual account. So how does Luke seem to know so much about Jesus and even those that were there? Well, I believe a lot of it had to, when Matthew writes his gospel, Matthew's writing from Matthew's perspective and Matthew's experiences and Matthew's life with Jesus. And when Mark writes his gospel, he was and had seen Jesus, but he hadn't spent a lot of time with Jesus. However, most of his information comes from Peter, who did. So Mark got a couple of his own experiences, but he's got a lot of Peter's experiences. So he's writing from Peter's perspective. John, the apostle that Jesus loved, as he calls himself, was writing from John's perspective, but not Luke. Luke is writing from the perspective of many, many, many different people. Luke is interful, or he has read the accounts. He has talked to so many eyewitnesses. He has so much information to draw from. Like an investigative journalist compiling a story from several information, Luke composes his gospel from all these eyewitnesses of the life and the ministry and the teachings and the miracles of Jesus. Just as if you go to court and they put one witness on stand and that witness is credible, you can get a conviction. But the more witnesses you have, the more credible the story becomes. And not only does the more credible it becomes, think about this, the more details, the more elaborate it becomes, because this person saw it from this perspective, this person may have missed something, this person saw that. So the more witness you have, the more credible the story is, but the more details get filled in, the more that the story becomes alive and the story becomes real. And this is what Luke has done. He's not wasted any time. He's talking to the eyewitnesses, and all these sources have come together, and Luke says, I got to write this account. Not because others haven't written an account, but because I have so much more to offer to the account. I've got all this other information to offer to that, and I've verified it, and I know it to be true, and I can't help but write about what I've seen and what I've heard. So after carefully consulting all these eyewitnesses, after carefully going through pages and pages of documents, reading these other accounts, doing this extensive research, paying attention to the smallest, the most minute detail, I mean, this is painstaking. This is hard work. But only after all the research is done does Luke write his first book of Jesus' life and ministry here on Earth, the book of Luke. Luke wants us to know that this is historical fact, that the places he talks about are verifiable, that the events that he talks about you can research and find out for yourself. This is not a theory. This is not a fable. This is not a fairy tale. This is not some kind of made-up story. Luke wants us to know for certain that these events, these things, rights that he writes of are accurate, verifiable, historical accounts. Now Luke goes all the way back to the beginning. He doesn't start with Jesus. He starts with John the Baptist, the one who was prophesied, the one who was predicted in the Old Testament by Isaiah 760 years approximately before Jesus was born, to announce this coming of the Messiah, our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And Luke, listen, as Luke writes in such a personal, such an intimate way, because he's writing to a single person, most believe. Having carefully investigated here from the beginning, I have decided to write a careful or orderly account for you. That's personal. I wrote it for you, most honorable Theophilus. Now, some of you here are too young to remember the old E.F. Hutton commercial, when E.F. Hutton speaks.
After Hutton listens.
All right. Well, you're all as used to know as me. Isn't that the way we are? If you're in a restaurant, and the table next to you is talking about something intimate, you're eating real slowly. Especially if you want to know for certain, if you want to know the truth, if you want to know the gospel. When somebody starts to speak in an intimate, personal way, it's just human nature. We don't always mean to, but isn't that what we do? So when somebody's writing something in a personal, intimate way, it makes us pay attention all that much more. Luke writes this carefully investigated, carefully written account of Jesus' life in just such a letter. The only thing we know about Theophilus in history, because he's only mentioned twice in history, once in the book of Acts, dear Theophilus, I'm writing to you. Dear Theophilus, in my last book I wrote to you, is that, like Luke, he's probably an Gentile. The other thing most people believe is that Theophilus was probably a high-ranking Roman officer. The title, most honorable, most translation uses most excellent, was reserved for high-ranking Roman officials. It's the same exact word that Paul uses when he's talking about Felix, most excellent Felix. When he's talking about Festus, most excellent Festus. Both of those we know from historical accounts were high-ranking officials in the Roman government. So we believe and know that not only was Theophilus Gentile, but he was also a high-ranking Roman officer who was at least seeking to know who Jesus was. So, again, this should be of particular interest to us because a Gentile writing to a Gentile. But what's really interesting to me is the translation of the word Theophilus. Theo. Theo means God in Greek. Philos, love. Theophilus means a lover or a someone who is dearly loved, a dear confidant that's held in a close bond of personal affection. Theophilus means lover of God or a friend of God. As you know, it's amazing. As Christians, we believe that God inspired the Bible. In both the Old Testament and the New Testament, the word we translate inspired means God breathed. God breathed it into man. And God takes this man, Luke, with all of his life experiences, all of his education, all of the things that he knew, and inspires Luke to write these scriptures and write them to a man named Theophilus. Now, we all know what it's like to be inspired. Had the pleasure of going over to Barbara's house the other night. She had these beautiful pictures that she has painted. She has amazing talent. But she was inspired to write or to paint those pictures. Some of you write songs. Some of you write a letter. Some of you do a poem, and you're inspired to do so. Sometimes that inspiration, I believe, comes from God. Well, Luke writes to this lover of God. And God, in his great sovereignty and his great wisdom, writes to all of us who are lovers of God. There's actually some theologians, I don't believe this, but some theologians that believe that when Luke writes his letter, he was writing to all of us, dear, honorable Theophilus. Because if we're a lover of God, in God's eyes, we're excellent, we're honorable. But I believe he was writing to a specific person that God inspired him to write to, but in the bigger picture of God and his wisdom and his sovereignty and his Holy Spirit, he is now waiting to all of us who are lovers of God. Good part about this is not only does Theophilus, the lover of God that Luke's writing to, can know about God and why he's writing this. By implication, God is telling us why he has given us the gospel of Luke. So you and I can be certain of the truth of everything you and I have been told. So that we can know for certain that everything that's written in these scriptures, without any doubt, we can know as certain. We can know for certain Jesus is exactly who he says he is. And you know, sometimes that can be great comfort or it can bring great fear, depending on where your relationship is with Jesus Christ. Because Jesus made some very big claims about himself. And if we know for certain that these claims are true, then it means we need to look deep and inward into our hearts. Because Jesus said, Jesus claimed to be God himself. Jesus claims the only way that we can receive salvation is through him. The only way into the kingdom of heaven is to make him Lord over our life. Not just Savior, but Lord, by putting our faith and trust in him and obeying his commands. And while we walk by faith and not by sight, what Luke is saying is you do not have to walk by blind faith. Walk by faith, but not by sight. But let me give you the data. Let me give you the information. Let me give you the proof. So you're not walking in blind faith. So he writes down everything. And he says, I want you to know for certain that these scriptures and what they speak about, this man we call Jesus, who says he's God, that he's the Savior to the world, that you can be certain that these are the truth. The sinless life of Jesus Christ, the sacrificial death for you and me because of our sin on a Roman cross is true. The fact that Jesus Christ was resurrected from the dead by the Holy Spirit, power of God, is true, and I have the verifiable evidence because I want you to be certain so you don't miss out on the kingdom of God in eternity and so you can live the abundant life that Jesus came to give you right now, right here on this earth. He said, I want you to be certain because I don't want you to miss out on anything. But then it becomes, how do we know we can trust Luke? I mean, how do we know, even though he did all this careful research, that Luke didn't make some kind of mistake? I want you to know. I investigated the investigators of the investigator. I did my homework as well. See, the thing is, many people have written about Luke. Many people have written about what we just talked about and the facts of Luke so that you and I can be certain of everything we've been taught. There were ancient historians that were around approximately the time Luke around. Irenaeus writes of Luke, Tertullian writes of Luke, Origen writes of Luke, Eusebius, all of those write and confirm Luke as the writer of this gospel, and each one in their own way, verify this doctor, this historian by the name of Luke, as well as Luke's eyewitnesses and to his writings. So we have both scripture from that period of time, and we have historians from that period of time that both verify Luke is the author of this, and that he traveled with the apostles, and that he spoke to the eyewitnesses. Folks, it again becomes elementary. We have to know that this is true. There's more evidence this is true than almost any other events in history, and yet there's a whole world out there to deny it. He says, you can be certain the truth I speak, and history backs that up. But what about modern day history? So I go searching for modern day. I investigate the modern day authenticity of the Bible, the authenticity of Luke, and I come upon dozens and dozens and dozens of quotes by modern day historians, modern day archaeologists. Charlie Campbell, an historian, writes, and I quote, there are dozens of writings outside the Bible that verify the historical accuracy of many of the names of people, places, and events mentioned in the Bible. American archaeologist, maybe some of you would recognize this name, William Albright. He writes, the reader may rest assured that nothing, nothing has been found by archaeologists to disturb a reasonable faith, and nothing has been discovered which can disprove a single theological doctrine. We no longer trouble ourselves with attempts to harmonize religion and science or to prove the Bible, for the Bible can stand for itself. You know, some people say, well, the Bible says the earth was created in 7 days. I know it wasn't. He just hadn't done the research. The word translated means a period of time. I just look at it and say, oh, that's how God did it. There's no conflict between science. There's never been a conflict between science and the scripture. Man makes the conflict. There is nothing. The Bible stands on itself. But my attention was particularly drawn to a historian by the name of Sir William Ramsay. Sir William Ramsay was the youngest son of a third generation lawyer. So, great-grandpa was a lawyer, grandpa was a lawyer, dad is a lawyer. They're very wealthy people. They're very influential people. And this gives Sir William Ramsay a heads up in a lot of areas of life, particularly in the area of education. So when Sir William Ramsay, or William Ramsay at that time, was young, he was sent to a school in Germany founded by a man by the name of F.C. Bauer. It's been said that F.C. Bauer hated the Bible. What we do know, and I forget the name of the exact teachings he taught of Greek, but what we do know is that he taught his students the higher criticism against the scriptures. He disbelieved the Bible, he didn't like the Bible, he didn't believe the Bible, and he taught his students the same thing, the higher criticism against the Bible. So here is this man, he gets it ingrained in him that the Bible was not true. Sir William Ramsay goes on to attend Oxford University, graduates from Oxford University. He earns 3 fellowships, which my understanding of fellowship, and there's different explanations of it, but the fellowship, I think, is like a higher academic scholarship. And most people find it difficult to find one. He has 3. In other words, you got to be really smart and do really, really good. Not only that, from Oxford, he earns 9 honorary doctorates. So I don't know if you went to him and said, hey, Dr. Ramsay, that is, until he caught the eye of the Queen of England. And the Queen of England knights him because of his world scholarship and the things that he has brought into it. So now he is Sir William Ramsay. But somebody else of importance took notice of him too. Pope Leo III. Pope Leo III gives Ramsay the gold medal for his advancements in the field of archaeology and history. So he's knighted by the Queen. He's got the gold medal from the Pope. So we can say, or at least I think we all can agree, that Sir William Ramsay has just a little bit of credibility. I mean, again, elementary, my dear Watson. But growing up under the influence of this teacher, F.C. Bauer, who discredited the Bible, really made Sir William Ramsay very much a skeptic and very much an unbeliever. Now, you add to this that the year is around 1880. Ramsay didn't die until 1939, but in 1880, archaeology was a new field. Nobody knew much of the world. And the only thing the world really knew of the areas in Asia Minor that Luke writes about in Luke and in Acts or were only found in Luke and Acts. Nobody else even had heard of these places. So this unknown science, archaeology, many of the cities and locations mentioned in the book of Acts and the book of Luke weren't known, and almost nothing is known of their civilization and their history and their politics at this time. Most people actually thought that the cities and the villages and the things that are mentioned in the Bible in 1880 were just made up. And so Ramsay decides to go on an extended study, a 10-year study, where he's going to go to Asia Minor, he's going to go to Turkey, he's going to go to Greece, he's going to go to Israel, he's going to go to all these places where Paul has visited and are mentioned in the book of Acts and the book of Luke, where Paul and Luke had been sent on these missionary journeys. You know, many of these, Paul's traveling with Luke as a companion at his side. And this is an extensive research project in these areas. So as Ramsay begins to do all this research in these areas, and at the time he began, the Gospel of Luke and the other book of the Gospel of Acts is all the evidence the world has, the only record the world has, these places even exist. Now I have to tell you, Sir William Ramsay doesn't go here to prove Luke. In fact, quite the opposite. He's a skeptic. He doesn't believe it. He's going there to prove that Luke is a liar. He's going there and he's going to get inexplicable proof that Luke is hopelessly inaccurate, that no man could know so much about an area that's been so long forgotten. He said it's an impossibility and it's going to be easy to prove. So Sir William, fully expected to find Luke to fabricate everything he wrote. So he's actually putting Luke on trial, and what he's really doing in effect is he's putting the entire Bible on trial, because if he can just prove Luke, He can disprove the whole Bible. If Luke's a liar, then everybody can be a liar. Sir William Abbott devoted his entire life to unearthing as much information as he could about the areas and the people that Luke writes about. So here's what, after all his studies, after 10 years of going in Asia Minor and Turkey and Israel and Greece, maybe the best archaeologist the world has ever known on Asia Minor, you know, certainly the best archaeologist of the late 19th and early 20th century has to say about Luke after all his research has been compiled. Here is what he says about Luke, who he originally thought out to prove to be a liar. He says this. He says, Luke is an historian of the first rank. Not merely are his statements of fact trustworthy, he is possessed of the true historic sense. He fixes his mind on the idea and plan that rules in the evolution of history and proportions the scale of his treatment to the importance of each incident. He seizes the important and critical events and shows their true nature at greater length, while he touches lightly or omits entirely much that was valueless for his purpose. In short, this author, meaning Luke, should be placed among the greatest of historians. This knighted archaeologist, given a gold medal by the Pope, graduated from Oxford University with 3 fellowships and 9 doctorate degrees, says Luke should be counted as of the greatest historians. To me, that holds a ton of weight. Luke says, I had decided to write a careful account for you, most honorable lover of God, most honorable Theophilus, most honorable Rob, most honorable Tara. You can be certain of the truth of everything you were told. You can be certain of the truth of everything in these scriptures. And because of his research, Sir William Ramsay became a believer. He began to be a follower of Christ because Luke has clearly told us, history has verified, that you and I and Sir William Ramsay can be certain of what's written in this Bible and of the things which have been fulfilled and the truths which we've been taught. So here's the good news. Here's the good news. No matter who you are, no matter what you've done, no matter what you're doing right now, salvation can be yours. Now listen to what I said and what I didn't say. Luke never says everyone is saved from the wrath of God that we deserve because of our sin. He never says that. What he says is that everyone can be saved from the wrath of God we deserve by his grace and his mercy through his Son, Jesus Christ. And historical evidence, both secular and scripture, verifies this is true. Luke tells us of the certainty that Jesus died for you and 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 me and you, all of us in here, and everyone in the world, regardless of their politics, regardless of their gender, regardless of their status in life, it doesn't matter. Luke talks more about those that are without than any other gospel writer. Do you have questions? Do you have questions more like Theophilus about the truths of who Jesus is or the truths of Scripture? Then Luke can help you know with certainty the truths which are in these Scriptures. Luke tells us not only, here's amazing, we skip over something. Luke tells us not only that Jesus come to save the lost. He tells us that Luke, that Jesus came to seek and save. He's looking for you. He's seeking. Luke 19, verse 10, for the Son of Man. And the Son of Man was Jesus' favorite title for himself. For the Son of Man came to seek and save those who were lost. He came to seek you. Do you know you're a sinner this morning and that you need a Savior from the wrath of God? Then Luke is the book for you. If you know you're a sinner, then Jesus is seeking you. But are you seeking Him? Are you living for Him so you can be saved? Are you putting your faith and your trust in Him? Are you broken this morning Do you feel rejected? Do you feel like an outcast? Are you living in poverty? Luke tells us and he shows us Jesus reaches out to the lowest of the low. Jesus, in the book of Luke, befriends the despised. He befriends the rejected, the fallen, the prodigals, the harlots, the immoral, the down-outs, the widows, the children, the poor, the social outcasts, and the broken and the lost, and even the enemies of society, like the Samaritans of the time. No matter who you are, no matter what you've done, no matter what you're doing, you can know with certainty God loves you. And he loves you so much that he sent his one and only son to die for you. No matter what you've done, no matter who you are, no matter what you're doing right now, eternal life with God can be yours. Abundant life on earth can be yours. Luke wants you to know with certainty, it doesn't matter who you are welcome in the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Are you Theophilus? Are you a lover of God? But have some questions about God and Jesus? Do you want to know for sure before you commit to a lifestyle of being a true disciple of Jesus and trying to live as he tells us to live? Then Luke is the book for you, because Luke writes so we can be certain of the truth that we're told. If you come to the Odyssey Church on a regular basis, you know a lot of times in the beginning of the message, I'll give you a question to think about or ponder on before we get started. And this week, I'm going to end with a message for you to think about, to meditate upon until next Sunday. If you knew for certain Jesus is who he says he is, what would your life look like? If you knew for certain Jesus is who he says he is, how would you live? If you knew for certain Jesus is exactly who he says he is, what would you do different than you're doing right now? If you knew for certain Jesus says to be a disciple, you must obey his command, would you do some things that you aren't doing now, or maybe stop doing some things you are doing now? If you knew for certain God always had your back and that he would never, ever let you down, would you trust him more and maybe live for him a little bit more passionately? If you knew everything which came your way, either good or bad, was sent by God to shape you into the image of his son, would you worship him in a more powerful way and rejoice in him more often and complain a whole lot less? It's elementary. This doctor, this great historian we know as Luke, tells us that if you're a Theophilus, if you're a lover of God, he has carefully investigated and carefully written. He has given us an orderly account of everything, all the way from the beginning. Luke has written this careful account for you and me, so that we can be certain of the truth of everything we've been taught in these ancient scriptures we call our Bibles. So I challenge you to come every week, whether you're a believer, whether you're a seeker, whether you're a non-believer, but especially if you're a seeker or a non-believer, or if you're a believer that has seekers or non-seekers, or seekers and maybe even non-believers, to come every week. Bring somebody with you. If you just need a little reassurance, come every week and bring a friend, so that the questions that you have, the questions that I have, so that we can know for certain the truth of Jesus Christ. So we can be so certain that God loves us. And he not only loves us and wants to save us, but he seeks after us all so we can glorify him. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you and I praise you in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord. And Father, we thank you for the people that are here today. And Lord, as we go our separate ways, let us ponder. Let us think about it. Let us meditate upon it. How would we live if we knew for sure Jesus Christ was exactly who he said he was? The Son of God, the giver of life, the way, the truth, and happiness. Bless these people as we leave. And I thank you and praise you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you all once again. Come next week expecting. We'll see what Luke has for us then. May the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.